50% of patients that are identified as need to return, there is a vital danger of interrupting treatment. A warm thank you to our colleagues for the stimulating presentations. These various experiences show the difficulties, but also encourage us to do more and to do better to assure access to health service for refugees, internally displaced people, and migrants. I think you have compellingly shown the urgent needs, but also the feasibility to obtain better access to HIV service, and this through various interventions, including advocacy, legal and policy changes, adaptations to services, outreach activities, and community-based approaches. Although being a migrant in itself does not necessarily have to mean less access, the reality is that refugees, asylum seekers, and undocumented migrants face limited access to adequate care for HIV, and that they have additional vulnerabilities, including to HIV infection. So people who remain outside the formal process face even more problems, as de facto they do not exist for the system, so their needs and rights remain unrecognized too. Moreover, lately we see a very worrying trend of criminalization of those health providers and organizations that try to support certain of those migrants. For people facing an end of stay permit, it's often also the end of access to care. They return into a clandestine situation and are often cut off from the HIV care they could access before. And some of them face deportation to their countries of origin without much assurance of continuity of care. In Belgium, for example, my own country, they include patients with poor clinical status or in need of treatments that for most will remain out of reach, second or third line ART, medicines for multi-resistant TB or opportunistic infections. It's estimated here that for about 50% of patients that are identified as need to return, there is a vital danger of interrupting treatment or inability to access the needed care. It would have been interesting to address also more in detail the effects of countries' migration policies on people's vulnerability to HIV infection. Many countries focus on deterring, containing, and detaining people. This creates access barriers to care, but certain of these migration policies also directly increase people's vulnerability and therefore increase the risk to HIV infection. As it is documented, there is quite high HIV infection rates in migrant communities, and especially linked to their socio-economic situation. So this precarity is reinforced due to deterring policies and measures, and it exposes people to high-risk coping mechanisms, violence and abuse. So studies in Europe, for example, have shown us that a high proportion of the HIV infection, the new HIV infection, happens not at the start or during the journey of migrants, but within the countries of destination, which reflects their socioeconomic precarity and the abuse also that people are facing. So this accumulated vulnerability at different stages of the migration process creates the need for specific attention and specific tailor-made measures in order to obtain an effective response to HIV. And this needs to be taken into account just as for other key populations, I would say. Mitigating both vulnerability of people, combining it with increased efforts for prevention, early detection and treatment, support to remain on treatment. As a final reflection, I just wanted to remind us of this new world that we're entering in, a world changed by COVID-19. The pandemic reinforces existing problems for migrants, and it faces them with three types of crisis, really. COVID-19 creates a health crisis with impact on migrants especially, because they have little ability to apply some of the protective and hygienic measures, as we've seen in the camps in Greece, for example. Secondly, they face a socio-economic crisis as most are cut off from their usual income from work in the informal sector. Remittances also are reduced, and they are often excluded from relief schemes. And thirdly, they face a protection crisis with borders closing, movement restrictions such as quarantine and curfews make that they are trapped in dangerous situations, exposed to violence and abuse. Recent reports from Southern Africa included examples where migrant sex workers have been targeted by the police. But we must remind ourselves that the COVID-19 pandemic can also create opportunities. As we've seen in Portugal, where migrants received a legal status in order to help them access care and other support measures. In Italy, migrant workers have been regularized for a period of 6 months. So it is also a time where these and other positive measures could be pushed to protect migrants, to recognize their health needs and their rights to care. And hopefully then to make these measures last, to reap the benefits for people living with HIV and the HIV response amongst migrants well beyond these COVID times.